ETF Prime is hosted by investment advisors of the ETF Store. This program is for informational purposes only and does not constitute investment advice. Investing in ETFs involves risk, including potential loss of principal. Any past performance figures discussed are not necessarily indicative of future results. The ETF Store is not affiliated with ETF.com or any of its affiliates. ETF.com's participation in this program should not be construed as an endorsement or an indication by ETF.com of the value of any ETF Store product or service. Visit ETFstore.com for more information.
Now it's time for ETF Prime, where we discuss everything you need to know about exchange-traded funds and the world of investing. Whether you're an investing expert or just starting out, Nate and Connor will help you get up to date on what's happening on Wall Street and show you how exchange-traded funds can help lower your investment costs, reduce your tax bill, and allow you to take advantage of investment opportunities around the world. And now, the host of ETF Prime, Nate Geraci.
Welcome to ETF Prime. Nate Geraci alongside Connor Kelly. As always, glad to have you with us. Excellent show lined up today. Of course, October was a tough month in the financial markets. The S&P 500 was down nearly 7%, worst month since 2011. International stocks were actually down more than that. Bonds were down, commodities. There simply weren't a whole lot of places to hide. In just a moment, we'll be joined by ETF.com's Laura Krieger to take a look at what ETF investors were doing during October. The latest ETF flow data is in. There are several interesting trends showing up that I think are worth discussing, and really not just in October, but year-to-date as well. So we'll do that here in just a moment. We'll then be joined by Lance Humphrey, portfolio manager on USAA's global multi-asset team. USAA currently offers four stock ETFs focused on the value and momentum factors. They also offer two actively managed bond ETFs. Connor, USAA is interesting to me personally because, you know, I grew up in a military family. Mm-hmm. My dad was 30 years Army. My brother's currently serving in the Army. And given that USAA's business is built around servicing military families, naturally, they both use USAA. I had the option to use USAA, which I do. But I've always thought of them as more of an insurance provider and maybe some other financial services. So to me, it's been interesting watching them get involved in ETFs. They just have a different DNA than some other fund companies.
And with Veterans Day coming up next week, Nate, I really think USA, you know, there isn't a better guest to have on
perfect
the program
for sure.
This week leading up to that. Sure, most people obviously associate USAA with the military. And myself, being a non-USAA member, it seems like based on their commercials, their focus has always been insurance and maybe even, you know, some banking services, right, for their members. But you're right. They do offer all kinds of financial services, including mutual funds and these ETFs that they launched in 2017. Obviously, anybody can buy their ETFs, not just USAA members, which is why excited to have them on the show. But look, the reality is that the factor space is crowded, and it's crowded with some big names out there backing ETFs. So I'm going to be really interested to see what Lance has to say on how USAA is attempting to stand out from the crowd with these factor-based ETFs that they launched.
Yeah, I think this will be a very interesting discussion. We'll close the show today with a tremendous guest, Dr. Victor Chow, Distinguished Professor of Global Business and Finance at West Virginia University. He developed the index behind the recently launched Vesper U.S. Large Cap Short-Term Reversal Strategy ETF. This has a great ticker symbol, by the way, UTRN, U-Turn. So we've all heard the phrase buy the dip, or maybe you've heard some more profane version of that. That's effectively what this ETF is trying to do on a short-term basis, buy the dip in stocks, capitalize on a short-term reversal. So I think this will be a fascinating conversation. As always, if you have questions or comments, you can visit etfprime.com, or you can find us on Twitter at Nate Geraci and at ckelly1980. All right, let's start today with ETF.com's Laura Krieger.
Time now for our weekly chat with the experts at ETF.com,
the world's leading independent authority on ETFs.
People have been saying there are too many mutual funds since the 80s. For all the talk of smart beta, they haven't pulled in huge assets. The active managers are showing up in the ETF space.
Laura, so we're going to talk ETF flows. But before we do that, I have to mention October was a record trading volume month for ETFs. In particular, bond ETFs have never seen more trade volume ever. And guess what? There were no issues with ETFs. Everything functioned exactly the way it was supposed to. Can we finally put to bed these ETFs haven't been tested yet claims? I mean, what else do the naysayers need to see at this point?
I really hope so. I mean, you hear these sorts of claims pick up after every little spot of volatility, but it's like we had ETFs during the great financial crisis. We had ETFs during the dot-com crash. I mean, we've had them for a while. They've been tested, and they've been tested through a lot worse than this. So the ETF structure hasn't kerploded the moment that volatility returned to the market. I think we can finally lay that to rest.
Well, and you know, I think some people forget ETFs were actually created to provide a liquidity buffer, right? After the 1987 stock market crash, they were created to help markets in times of stress. That is literally why they were invented. It's always interesting to me that these claims are still out there. I have to mention Dave Nodig had a great piece out this morning on ETFs as shock absorbers. Highly recommend reading that if you want to do a deeper dive. But let's talk ETF flows. Even though the markets were down in October, ETFs actually took in a little bit of money. Give us a recap here. What stood out to you in terms of ETF flows?
Sure. Well, one point I wanted to make about the volumes, if we can step back just a second, the fact is that we saw a lot of the ETFs with the highest amount of volume were the ETFs that were used as trading vehicles. So to your point, you know, ETFs being used as shock absorbers, as being, these instruments of liquidity, well, that's exactly what we saw. We saw SPY and AG and LQD and JNK, these huge trading instrument, trading vehicle style ETFs. They were the ones attracting most of the volume, and that's because active managers were using them to effectively change their portfolios around. So I just wanted to bring that up because I think it kind of goes back to your point about ETFs being the shock absorber for the market and so on. So, but to your question about ETF flows, the thing that stood out, I think, to me, first and foremost, was what you mentioned at the top of the segment, which is that bond ETFs saw outflows. And this is the first time we've seen outflows from bonds in 3 years, roughly 3 years. The iShares Core Aggregate Bond ETF, that's ticker AG, the largest bond ETF on the market, it saw $2.6 billion in outflows this past month. But the Vanguard Bonds, Total Bond Market ETF, BND, which is basically the same, it tracks basically the same index, that saw just a teeny tiny bit of inflows. So, but that's still like chump change because BND brings in hundreds of millions of dollars in a month. We definitely saw some major outflows in the bond ETF space as a whole.
Laura, if you look at it, well, I was going to ask if you look at the bond ETF flows, what's interesting to me is overall there were outflows, but if you look at shorter term or floating rate bond ETFs, there have been pretty significant inflows. I actually saw ETF.com's ETF of the week last week was the Spider Bloomberg Barclays 1-3 month T-bill ETF BIL. That took in nearly $1 billion. And was in the top 10 of inflows for October. The JP Morgan Ultra Short Income ETF, JPST, that was also in the top 10 of inflows. And then if you look year to date, the iShares Short Treasury Bond ETF, SHV, and the iShares Floating Rate Bond ETF, FLOT, those are both in the top 10 of inflows again for the year. I think Mint, the PIMCO Short Maturity ETF, that's taken in a bunch of money. So if you look at this, maybe more holistically, do you think this is all just rate driven? investors moving out of longer duration and into shorter?
I think that's probably a large part of it. Yeah, I think with rates rising, investors are trying to position their portfolios to not just lessen the sting of rising rates, but also to just keep themselves flexible. Whatever the future lies ahead, right? Or whatever lies ahead in the future, I should say.
Okay, so what about on the equity side?
Okay, so on the equity side, we saw some kind of interesting stuff happening. So during the most volatile parts of the volatile market swings, we actually saw net inflows into some of the bigger market bellwether funds, your SPY, your IVV, and your VOO. And that might sound a little counterintuitive at first, but the reason it happened is kind of simple. The reason is that the price of the underlying S&P 500 stocks for these ETFs grew cheap compared to the price of the ETFs themselves. And that kind of caught the interest of authorized participants, who are the investors who make new ETF shares and destroy the ETF shares. So they kind of, their radar got pinged, and this price disconnect got them buying the underlying stocks and selling ETF shares, which, means you ultimately end up with a bunch of new creations in the market, which is what we saw. So as for whether, investors writ large, mom and pops who are not in the authorized participant business, whether they were, buying the dip and all of that, I think we saw them pivoting into lower cost products. So, IVV and VOO, like I mentioned, they were big winners for October. They're the buy and hold version of the S&P 500 ETF. SPY, meanwhile, is much more of a trader's vehicle, as we talked about earlier. Well, that had net outflows. So to me, that kind of suggests that traders are, they're doing their thing. Traders going to trade, right? But investors, buy and hold investors are getting in and they're staying in.
Well, what's interesting, too, I was looking at year-to-date flows, and this sort of fee rotation is really pronounced. You do have IVV and VOO taking in large sums of money. And then if you look at the top two international ETFs, the iShares Core MSCI EFA ETF IEFA and the iShares Core MSCI Emerging Markets ETF IEMG, those four, those are your top four in inflows. IEFA is actually number one. And then, on the other side of the equation, if you look at SPY, EFA, EEM, those are all in the top five of losers. So, it's interesting just seeing this continued fee rotation. One question I had on the international ETFs, performance has been pretty rough this year, right? IFA is down over 8%. IEMG is down about 13%. And, again, with those, I know there's been some fee rotation in the space, but are you surprised at the inflows into international ETFs just given the performance?
I'm not too surprised. I think that whenever performance dips, people are going to use that as a chance to buy in. But I also think the key point here is that some of these international funds that you mentioned are ex-US. And, not only are they cheap, but they don't have exposure to U.S. stocks, which, depending on how you feel about where the U.S. economy is headed in the near term or the medium term, especially with the elections coming up, today, actually, that may or may not appeal to you, right? So,
What about the Communication Services Select SPDR ETF, XLC? This thing took in nearly $2 billion in October, and it's taken in nearly $4 billion since its launch, which was only back in June. I'm curious, is this money just coming out of some other products after the GIX reclassification?
I am so glad you brought up XLC. I'm so glad, because I think this is just a fascinating example of, I think it's a fascinating case. So XLC, like you said, is one, the new sector ETF brought online to kind of reflect the new GIX sector. We saw, and the GIX change went into effect in September, right? So we saw some investors moving into XLC prior to the GICS change. But what we have seen in October is that a lot more didn't move over before that changeover, and we're seeing them move into it now. So XLC brought in almost $2 billion last month. That's the third most of any ETF on the market. At the same time, we saw XLK, which is the State Street Tech Sector ETF, and XLY, which is the Consumer Discretionary ETF, both of them lost almost $2 billion in the past month as well. So, and that's partly because they were affected by the GICS change. The FANG stocks were moved out of the tech sector. There were some new, like I think Alibaba and other e-commerce marketplaces were moved into consumer discretionary. So, you know, there was some rejiggering around, and I think that what we're seeing now is that investors are looking at their sector exposure and saying, hey, wait a minute, this isn't behaving like I think it ought to. Let me rejigger things around a little bit.
Yeah, I think it's going to be fascinating continuing watching what happens with all of those ETFs. Laura, we have just a couple of minutes left here. Going back to year-to-date flows, when I was looking at the numbers last week, it was interesting. The top two in inflows were, of course, iShares and Vanguard. But then the next three were Schwab, JP Morgan, and First Trust. So absent from that list was State Street and Invesco, which I think may surprise some investors. Do you have any thoughts on that?
I think it's fascinating watching the league tables and seeing how all the jockeying is happening. You know, we're really only just a few months away, I think, from seeing Charles Schwab overtake Invesco. All they need is a couple of more good months like they had, and maybe they will be third instead of Invesco. And I think the drivers here are twofold, right? So one, it's this continuing fee war that we talked about. State Street and Invesco, they have plenty of cheap ETFs in their portfolios. And in fact, the cheapest, the ones that they have that are cheapest in their class are still bringing in assets. But the other old stalwarts of the space, the SPYs, the EEMs, that sort of thing, they're just not cheap enough, right? And you also see this too for Invesco, which, you know, PowerShares used to be like the name in smart beta, right? But now everybody and their grandmother has a smart beta ETF now, and a lot of them are cheaper than Invesco's products. So, you know, Invesco has been doing a lot of M&A lately. We'll see if that helps kind of build out their bench a little bit or whatnot. But, you know, it's definitely a fee war thing happening here. But the other thing, too, and this goes to why we've seen JP Morgan and First Trust bring so many assets in year to date. And it's something that Eric Balchunas over at Bloomberg calls bring your own assets, BYOA. You know, these are big asset managers with lots of clients, existing client assets and other vehicles that they can just sort of funnel over to their ETF products. And we saw this, we saw JP Morgan do this to great effect over starting in the summer. They've just been funneling billions of dollars into their beta builder products, you know, the Japanese one, the Canadian equities one, so on and so forth. And now we're seeing it with JPSC, although, you know, part of that, too, is what we talked about earlier with the rate hikes and people trying to position their portfolios with a short-term bond ETF. But, you know, this is definitely JP Morgan and First Trust eating their own lunch.
No, for sure. And then I would add, just with somebody like Charles Schwab having a brokerage platform, having a captive audience, that's certainly been a tailwind for them in gathering assets. Laura, always appreciate the insight. Thank you for joining us this week.
Thank you for having me on.
That was ETF.com's Laura Krieger. Let's take a break. And when we come back, we'll be joined by Lance Humphrey, portfolio manager on USAA's Global Multi-Asset Team. We'll take a look at USAA's ETF lineup. You're listening to ETF Prime. Welcome back to ETF Prime. Nate Geraci alongside Connor Kelly. Our next guest is Lance Humphrey, portfolio manager on USAA's global multi-asset team. USAA currently offers six ETFs. There are four factor-based stock ETFs and then two actively managed bond ETFs. Those ETFs now have over $1 billion invested in them. And interestingly, USAA did not enter the ETF space until October of last year. So all of those assets have come within the past 12 months or so. And of course, USAA is a unique firm in the financial services space, just given their focus on military families. They also have a unique organizational structure, particularly on the insurance side. Lance is joining us via phone today from San Antonio. Lance, great having you on the program.
Nate, great to be here. Appreciate it.
Lance, I thought a good place to start might be to have you provide some background on how USAA first got involved in ETFs, because it wasn't until about a year ago that USAA first made that leap. So what was the catalyst here? Why did USAA make that jump?
Well, that's right. So, again, we launched our six ETFs in October of last year, but really what was the main driver and catalyst leading into that was the fact that from our asset allocation side, again, our target retirement funds, our target risk funds, we had been using ETFs really pretty heavily over the past 6 years. If we, again, go back 5-6 years ago, we had been using your traditional passive ETFs for our tactical exposures. But even then, we began to start building positions in many smart beta ETFs. And so throughout that due diligence process, we were really diving deeply into factor-based investing and how to construct portfolios, how to combine different factors together, to where ultimately it led us to a point where we felt that there was a particular way that we could bring factors to market that didn't exist in the marketplace at the current time. And so our thought was, we're one of the largest buyers of smart beta ETFs in the marketplace today, and there's a particular type of product we would love to see. And so what we did is we worked with our product management team to help develop a product that we would want to be an investor alongside of our shareholders with within our own portfolios. And so ultimately, that was the genesis of us building a suite of these types of ETFs.
Okay, so again, USAA currently offers six ETFs, four on the equity side, and then two actively managed bond ETFs. Your largest ETF by assets is a USAA MSCI USA Value Momentum Blend Index ETF, ticker symbol ULVM. So let's maybe dig a bit deeper into this one. This is a quote-unquote smart beta ETF. So walk us through the construction. How are holdings determined? How are they weighted? And why the focus on value momentum?
Yeah, great question. So again, as you mentioned, I think that when we look across the landscape, particularly in the multi-factor space and smart beta, there's a lot of products. We own several of them that have a focus on multiple factors, whether it's value, momentum, quality, volatility, size, and we believe in all those factors. But again, going back to our research, you know, there was two factors that really stood out to us as two factors that we wanted to have in our portfolio at all times. The ones that were the most researched, most grounded in both academic and practitioner research, and that was value and momentum. Again, not only for their standalone characteristics, which we can touch on, but the fact that those two in particular also pair very well together from a diversification standpoint. So again, we wanted to build a product that really focused on really the two all-star factors in our mind, being value and momentum. But I think more importantly, and you touched on this, was then how do we construct the portfolio? And that's where we spent a lot of time in the development of these ETFs, where we look across the marketplace today. Again, the ETF landscape in general is dominated by ETFs that are weighted by their market capitalization. And we think whenever you're taking an active approach, which we would consider smart beta being active, it doesn't necessarily make sense to choose names in accordance to how large they are from a market capitalization standpoint. But instead, we focus very strongly on diversification. So what we wanted to do was select a group of stocks that we find to be attractive on their value and momentum characteristics. But from there, we wanted each of those names to approximately contribute an equal amount of risk across the portfolio. So we didn't want just the largest 1, 2, 3, or 4, or 5 names to really dominate the risk. We want the risk to be spread out across the entire spectrum of names that we choose within the portfolio. So how does that manifest itself within the ETF itself? Well, what we're doing is we're looking at the universe. In the case of ULVM, it's the MSCI USA index, and we're choosing the top 25% of the names in that index based on their combined value and momentum score, which is important when I say combined because we're looking for stocks that have characteristics of both value and momentum. So we want to buy stocks that are attractively priced and showing signs of improvement. And so from there, again, we take the top 25% of those names. And then importantly, we weight those names by their risk. So essentially, it's the inverse of the risk of those names, to where that 25% is approximately equally contributed throughout the portfolio, to where stocks that have a little bit higher risk get a slightly lower weight within the portfolio, and stocks that have a slightly lower risk get a slightly higher weight, again, to help balance the risk across the portfolio.
Lance, can you tell us a little bit more about the specific criteria used for each factor, value, momentum? You know, there's been a lot of discussion lately around the definition of different factors. I actually saw a great comment from Cambria's Med Faber last week. He said, quote, "The word value is sort of like the word dog. A beagle looks nothing like a Great Dane, but both dogs." And, you know, I thought that was a good, colorful description. How do you define value momentum?
Sure. So first I'll answer your question, and I'll expand on that a little bit. So within the value side of the portfolio, we're defining value by price to earnings, enterprise value to cash flow, and price to book. Again, it's important, those three, because we want to have one metric from each of the main financial statements from each company. And then more importantly, I think, is that we want to use multiple signals for value. And I think that, again, whether it's those three in particular or a different three, we're strong believers that you want to use multiple metrics when defining value. Because what we find, if you look in the data, is oftentimes on one specific metric, a certain stock may have had a recent merger or acquisition, which could really throw that number off. But what we find is when you begin to average those metrics together, it helps us converge more accurately on companies that are genuinely attractively valued. On the momentum side, we're using 12-month and 6-month momentum, excluding the most recent month, and we're doing that on a risk-adjusted basis. For any of the listeners that are familiar with some of the larger factor-based ETFs out there, you'd mentioned in the name of our ETF, we do use MSCI as an index provider. There's two ETFs out there, VLUE, which is the MSCI Enhanced Value Index, and MTUM, which is the MSCI Momentum Index. Those are both offered by BlackRock. It's the same factor definitions that are used within those two ETFs. And so, again, we wanted investors to be able to look at a live track record of how those factors had performed out of sample. But more importantly on that, I think, you know, to Meb Faber's quote, I think that, you know, the definition of value is important, and you can certainly get different return characteristics based on the definition of value. But frankly, I think that that has less of an impact on the returns than some of the other considerations when putting these portfolios together, like how do you weight the names that you've selected within your value portfolio, or what's the level of concentration? Are you choosing the top 10% of the names, the top 50% of the names? Those can even have more dramatic differences in returns in the factor itself. So I think that the definitions are important, but again, I think the most important part of that is to average multiple factors together to help get a more accurate answer.
Now, USAA also offers a small cap U.S. version, ticker USVM, a developed international version, UIVM, and then an emerging markets version, UEVM. Are all of those using effectively the same underlying methodology, just a different stock universe?
They are. So they're all using the exact same methodology, the difference being within the small cap and the emerging market space, we do use a small liquidity filter where we remove the bottom 10% of names from the universe based on their liquidity, just to ensure that these ETFs are able to perform well in market after trading costs and after implementation costs, which is something that's critically important to us.
And Lance, just high level, look, every investor is going to have a unique situation, but how do you think multi-factor strategies like this should be used in a portfolio?
Well, the way that we use them in our own portfolio, and I think many investors could utilize the same approach, is that the multi-factor portfolios can be the core of your portfolio. So again, when we think about how we construct portfolios, we like to have a large part of our equity portion in multi-factor core factors that have been well-researched, well-proven over time. And then from there, you can follow somewhat of a core satellite approach where you can use single factors or different types of products to help refine that exposure, whether it be tactical or strategic, or whether you have discretionary views. So for us, using value and momentum in particular are going to serve as the bedrock or the core of our equity portfolios.
All right, I want to make sure to briefly touch on the fixed income side as well. USAA offers two ETFs, including the USAA Core Intermediate Term Bond ETF, ticker UITB. And as I mentioned earlier, both of these are actively managed. Why go the active management route on the bond side, given that you're going rules-based on the equity side?
Well, you touched touched on it at the beginning. I think when we think about USAA, we have a very long legacy of fixed income, active fixed income management. Again, our asset management company has been around since the early 1970s, and being an insurance company, we have a lot of expertise in active fixed income. And what we wanted to do, when we think about the six ETFs as a whole, we just talked about on the equity side, we believe value and momentum, multi-factor construction can serve as a core part of an investor's portfolio. We feel the same way on the fixed income side, but with active management. So when we look across our own portfolios where we're managing on behalf of our membership, actively managed fixed income from skilled teams is going to be the predominant core of that portfolio. So when we think about the six ETFs, you have two active fixed income, four multi-factor equity portfolios. We think that our membership and advisors can use those as a core holding within their portfolio. And again, we think that we have a long legacy of demonstrating our expertise in active fixed income management.
So, Lance, that actually brings up a good question. I know you can't go into specifics regarding USAA's longer-term ETF strategy, but can you perhaps give us a sense as to how USAA might approach the ETF market moving forward as it relates to new ETF launches? You know, obviously, you have the six ETFs now, as you mentioned, can really represent the core of a portfolio. I believe I saw a stat that USAA overall has something like $6 or $7 billion invested in ETFs. Obviously, not just USAA ETFs, but all types of ETFs. So, you know, will the impetus be to maybe look in spaces where you think a USAA ETF could be used on the institutional side? Are you going to be looking at, you know, individual investor demand? What will be sort of the overriding strategy there?
No, I think that's exactly right. You mentioned it. We have over $6 billion today within our own products on the ETF space. And that's always going to be a driving factor when we think about what products we can bring to market. What we're not going to be is one of the, you know, largest providers that are going to have a menu of 100 or 200 ETFs and continue to manufacture those out. We are a very member-focused and advisor-focused organization, and what we want to do is build and provide products that we know that our membership can benefit from, whether it's because we are putting it in portfolios that we manage on their behalf, or it's an ETF or a product that they are demanding to us directly. So I think that when we think about future launches, it's going to continue to follow that same spectrum where it will be a product that we believe we can use within our own products that we don't see in the marketplace today, or on the fixed income side, an area where we have demonstrated expertise on the active management side, and that we could then build that out for our membership as well.
All right, lastly, you mentioned your membership. I think most people are aware USAA has a very deep connection with military families. So the company was founded by U.S. Army officers. Membership is primarily active duty and retired military personnel, along with their families. To close here today, can you just talk a little bit about the history and culture of USAA? Of course, Veterans Day is upcoming on Sunday, so perfect time having you on the show. But give us some background.
Sure. Well, first of all, in regards to Veterans Day, I do want to say thank you to all the veterans out there listening. Absolutely a core part, and it's really what USAA is all about, so we do certainly appreciate everyone's service. But to your point, we were founded in the 1920s by a small group of military officers who were unable to acquire insurance because their job was more dangerous. And so the insurance companies did not want to underwrite their vehicles or whatever it may be. And so a small group of the officers got together and said, well, why don't we self-insure one another? We'll pull money together, and if something happens to one of us, we'll pull from this pool. So again, that's now nearly 100 years in the making. We've continued to grow to over 10 million members today. USAA is available to all current and former Armed Service members. So whether you're active duty or a veteran, USAA products are available to military members and their families. So again, going back 100 years from the property and casualty side, in the 1970s was when we began our asset management company. So again, a very long legacy of serving the military community.
Yeah, and one thing we should absolutely point out, because of their structure, ETFs can be accessed by anyone, right? You don't have to be a USAA member to invest in USAA ETFs, which is a great thing and certainly something we should mention.
That's exactly right. The investment products in general, so whether it's our traditional 40 Act mutual funds or our ETFs, those are going to be available to the general public. You can come directly to USAA or work with your financial advisor, and those would be available.
Well, Lance, we'll have to leave it there. Really enjoyed the conversation today. Thank you for joining us.
Nate, I enjoyed it. You guys have a great afternoon.
That was Lance Humphrey, portfolio manager on USAA's global multi-asset team. Let's take a break, and when we come back, We're going to spotlight a unique ETF that just launched a little over a month ago, the Vesper Large Cap Short-Term Reversal Strategy ETF. We'll be joined by Dr. Victor Chow, who actually developed the index behind this ETF. We'll do that right after break. You're listening to ETF Prime. Welcome back to ETF Prime. Nate and Connor in studio. Now it's time for our ETF Spotlight.
It's time for the ETF Spotlight, where each week we highlight one exchange-traded fund. There are thousands of ETFs available to invest in. ETF Prime has sorted through them all, so you don't have to.
The ETF we're spotlighting this week is the Vesper U.S. Large Cap Short-Term Reversal Strategy ETF. And this has a great ticker symbol, by the way, UTRN, U-Turn. And joining us via phone from Morgantown, West Virginia, to discuss the methodology behind this ETF is Dr. Victor Chow, Distinguished Professor of Global Business and Finance at West Virginia University. Victor, a pleasure having you on the program today.
It's my pleasure to.
Victor, so you actually developed the index behind this ETF. You developed what's called the Chow Ratio, which seeks to identify stocks with the greatest potential for a weekly rebound. Before we get into the details here, how did you get involved with this to begin with? Tell us more about your background.
Yes, I am a professor at West Virginia University for almost 30 years. And during this time, my primary job is doing research. And I have found out there's a lot of good theoretical model and methodology, which is very useful to the portfolio managers using in the real world. So that's the reason I like to do here is to bring these theoretical model to the real practice.
All right, so let's talk about the index behind U-Turn. It's comprised of 25 stocks. Explain for us the process here. How exactly are these stocks selected?
Okay, there's a theory behind this. I create a ratio called Chow Ratio. And the ratio actually is considered very simple. It's the return over the risk. The idea is based on the behavioral bias. We all know that there's a lot of research report. The investor behavioral bias usually happen in a very short period of time. Now, these two biases are basically caused by the emotional bias. So due to the bias, the volatility of the stock return is not symmetric. So what does that mean is that because people have different reactions between the upside gain and the downside loss, so investors tend to realize the gain much faster than take the loss. So many times in a short period of time, if a stock is relatively healthy, I call healthy stock, the relative stable return over a period of time, but suddenly experience some short-term shock or short-term uncertainty, then investor usually have this called emotional bias, tend to try to take the profit and realize their original gain. So on the other hand, if the stock continuously going down and people have the loss aversion and not try to realize the loss. So due to this bias, we know that the volatility is asymmetric. And the Chow ratio is trying to take advantage of that and using the ratio between the return and the volatility to create a ratio, try to select. The stocks tend to be had a lower downside volatility, but had a more potential upside return. Now, in the theory, there's a lot of people talk about the short-term reversal. And the short-term reversal is based on, just I mentioned before, it's based on the behavioral biases. So in the very short period of time, when the people selling the stock too fast and cause the price decline, the later price discovery will reflect some kind of compensation for what we call liquidity provision. And this liquidity provision actually is a major source for the short-term reversal profit. So the Chao ratio is taking care in two sides, the upside potential return from the short-term reversal, at the same time control the denominator, is the downside risk exposure through a different type of method. Well, I have on my own unique methodology to measure this kind of risk. So using this Chao ratio, I am able to select the stocks which had the highest, the best potential to keep the return, at the same time minimize downside risk. So using the Chao ratio, I select the 25 stocks from the S&P 500 investment population.
So, Victor, if I were to restate this, effectively what the CTF is doing, if there are stocks in the S&P 500 that have some sort of catalyst that causes a sharp short-term down move, maybe there's a product recall, some sort of regulatory action, there's something in the news, what you're saying is investors have a tendency to overreact to this news in the short term and perhaps sell to the downside. And what you're looking to do is capture that snapback, capture the stock sort of bouncing back because of this overreaction of the short-term news. Is that a good way to state that?
Right. I try to use this ratio to discriminate between, I call, healthy stock and unhealthy, because we know that the short-term reaction is based on emotional or behavior biases. And the methodology is able to look at that to actually classify the stock into the category, which is a good stock, right? It just experienced a very short period of time of what we call abnormal or non-normal reaction. And then these type of stock had the most potential to rebound after a week.
Out of curiosity, how much of the portfolio turns over on a weekly basis? What's average?
Because the short-term volatility is very dynamic. It changes all the time due to the information. So the turnover of the selection is around 85 to 90% on a weekly basis.
Are the underlying transaction costs involved with that just due to the higher turnover? Is that a drag on returns at all?
Yeah, you mentioned a very important point. If this happening 10 years ago, it's almost impossible to develop this strategy in ETF. But today it's different because the increase of the trading technology and the efficiency of trading, one hand is reducing the transaction cost. Second, is that through the ETF, the in-kind basket trading, based on the stock exchange, not necessarily have to sell the stock and rebuy the stock, but more like the swap, that kind of mechanism significantly reduced the transaction cost. The reason I select the S&P 500 because there's a liquidity issue. With the S&P 500, I don't have any type of e-liquidity risk. So with the low liquidity risk plus the efficiency of trading mechanism, today this strategy become much more realistic.
So, Victor, that actually brings up a good question. Once a strategy like this is packaged up, and we always like to say ETFs have democratized investing, is there any risk that this anomaly goes away or becomes severely diminished just because it is accessible to everybody?
Yeah, you mentioned a very important point. Now, we see a lot of strategies just come and go. This time, this strategy is different because it's not really called strategy. It's more like a measurement. It's like a performance index. Chao ratio is trying to use the index to select the stocks had a potential to maintain upside gain at the same time to minimize the downside loss, the downside risk. So it's a rules-based. The rule will never change. And the rules was developed based on the systematic component inside the market return variation. So I can answer your question is that since this is the market rules mechanism, so it will not really change that over time.
All right, Victor, we have about a minute left here. Where do you think a strategy like this belongs in a portfolio?
Well, this strategy belongs to a portfolio. I think if it is a really a long-term holding strategy. So I would strongly recommend people to consider that if you hold a portfolio for a long-term basis, for maybe just retirement or maybe for trust or insurance, and this could be a very idea to hold for long term. And I don't mean that this should be replace your core portfolio, but it would be a very good satellite portfolio to try to minimize or mitigate the downside risk exposure.
Well, Victor, we'll have to leave it there. Really appreciate your time today. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
That was Dr. Victor Chow, Distinguished Professor of Global Business and Finance at West Virginia University. Again, the ETF is the Vesper U.S. Large Cap Short-Term Reversal Strategy ETF. And you can learn more about the Chow Ratio at chowratio.com, and then more about the ETF by visiting utrn.com. That's U-T-R-N.com. Connor, this is fascinating to me because, you know, there's certainly, it's like a short-term value play, right? And that you're looking for stocks where investors have overreacted to bad information or news or some other catalyst in the short term, hoping to see that stock snap back. At the same time, you have to weed out stocks that might be getting beat up for good reason, right? There may be a good reason why the mm-hmm. stock has sharply declined, but all over a weekly period. And you talked about the turnover in the ETF. I think this is fascinating. Here you have somebody who, you know, this is the Distinguished Professor of Global Business and Finance at West Virginia University, has a long career in studying, you know, sort of the academic underpinnings behind stocks and developed this ratio. Pretty interesting.
Well, and he put it well. 10 years ago, before the advent of ETFs, or at least the proliferation of ETFs and very inexpensive trading, this isn't doable. You can't effectively run a portfolio with 80 to 90% turnover on a weekly basis, and you asked him about that, right? The drag on returns, but you know he made a good point. Like trading is extremely inexpensive, and he picked the S&P 500 for that reason. You know, there's some of the 500 largest, most widely traded stocks on earth, and then you added the fact that with the creation redemption process within ETFs, a lot of the times it's more of a swap of stocks, of holdings, without actually realizing, you know, trades or buying and selling, that it's pretty darn efficient for the end owner. Now, I would say this is probably something you want to own in a tax-qualified account, not necessarily in a trust or a taxable account, because undoubtedly there would be some gains with a strategy like this. But I mean, just a fascinating concept, and I'm really interested in seeing how this fund does perform moving forward.
That's what I was going to say. I mean, it has the right ticker, pretty interesting strategy. So what will it come down to?
Performance.
Performance. All right. Podcasts of ETF Prime are available at etfprime.com, etf.com, iTunes, and Spotify. You can follow us on Twitter at Nate Geraci and at CKelly1980. Next week, Todd Rosenbluth, Senior Director of ETF and Mutual Fund Research at CFRA, will join us to cover a variety of ETF topics. We might actually have to throw our rapid-fire ETF Q&A at Todd again. And then Dave Chinaki, Portfolio Manager at Sabretooth Advisors, will spotlight the AdvisorShares New Tech and Media ETF, which owns a lot of the big tech stocks, the FANG stocks, which have obviously been challenged recently. So we'll find out what Dave thinks is in store moving forward. Until then, have a great week, everyone.